Hey Father Dad, don't cry anymore. Mama's there underneath the floor. Brother Dad, please find the door.
Worked with Alan for just shy of 20 years. I really can't give reminiscences because for me, I think he's some, I don't embody him. Maybe in some little way, he might embody a little part of me. Not the poetry part. He taught me how to do his business. He taught me how to do his business as a Buddhist, and I'm not a Buddhist. But he taught me Buddhist values. And he showed me through 19 and a half years how to pay attention, how to honor people, how to form an argument that is flawless. He taught me how to make things happen. And what Alan did, he brought people together like he's brought us together. He remembered everybody he came in contact with. And then when he got a piece of information, he would send it to that person and then tell that person to send it to this person. And sometimes it was a little redundant and maybe the person over there would get it five times, but he got it. And it worked, and Alan kept the information, and this is why he needed a staff. This is why not every poet needs to have a staff of two, sometimes three, sometimes four people, because Alan was a workmaker, and I think his work was really valuable for our society. And I believe, in that sense, it's our shared possibility to not let that work fall down, because we all have this within us to be able to do, to take activity, to write a letter, to call somebody, to keep a piece of information in a file and pull it out 5 years later and hand it to somebody else. This is not hard. It just takes mindfulness. And this is what Alan showed us over all these years. And then the fact is, he was also a truly great poet for millenniums. So that was the added bonus to Alan.
Well, I think that Alan's encouragement of me was manifestation of one of the things that I find very important, which is love of the common people. And no matter how famous and well-known Alan became, it seemed like he always had time for most people. He would answer questions, amazing patience. And with me, he would introduce me to famous people every once in a while. He introduced me to Andy Warhol at Studio 54. That was something. That was, I think, my first time in New York City since I'd been a child. Chogyam Trungpa, he told him, Andy's just back from Texas. And I told Trungpa, yeah, but I'm going to have to move to Denver with the other Americans. See, we were in Boulder. And he said, it's hard for people like me. He says, the hard truth. And he says, Texas, I was just down there drilling for oil, Trungpa said. And I said, well, what's going to happen when all the oil's gone? You know, then what? And he says, perhaps we'll find greater treasures. And Alan said, what greater treasures? And Trungpa said, treasures of the mind, Alan. And I said, expletive that, I want real treasure. And Trungpa thought that was funny. Another time he introduced me to Jerry Brown and said, this is my political advisor. And Jerry Brown said, oh yeah, who are you working for? I says, Mazza Masonry. And he looked at me, he says, oh. And I realized then that he wanted to be me more than I wanted to be him.
And so today, I wanted to stop by. I have a crazy schedule, as you know, Marie. But I want you to come up here 1 second, if you will. This young lady.
Be liberal.
This old lady.
It's true.
This young lady has done more for the arts and the crafts and the fine arts than anybody I know in this area. No one's done more. Back in the 80s at the Passaic County Community College, she was having meetings about poetry and having famous poets come in, and sometimes in the beginning very few people would show up.
Yeah, three.
I was one of them.
I remember that.
But she has stood the course. She is precious because she keeps the word of Allen Ginsberg perpetuated. That's how significant she is. She's important to our children, so we need to make sure we give her our support. The halls of Congress are not where it happens. It happens in the Patterson Museum. God bless you. Thank you.
So it's things I'll not do. Never go to Bulgaria. Had a booklet, an invitation. Same Albania. Invited last year privately by lottery scammers or recovering alcoholics or enlightened poets of the antique land of Hades Gates. Nor visit Lhasa, live in Hilton or Nawan Gelek's household and weary ascend Patala. Never, nor ever return to Kashi, oldest continuously habited city in the world. Bathe in Ganges, sit again at Manikarnika Ghat with Peter. Visit Lord Yaganath again in Puri. Never back to Birbhum, take notes, tales of Kaki Baba. Or hear music festivals in Madras with Philip. Or return to have chai with older Shunil, the young coffee shop poets. Or tie my head on a block in the Chinatown opium den, passed by Muslim hotel, its rooftop, Tin Smith Street, Chidri Chow, Nimtala burning ground, nor smoke ganja on the Hubli. Nor the alleyways of Ahmed's Fez, never more drink mint tea at Soko Chico, visit Paul Bowles in Tangier, or see the Sphinx in desert at sunrise or sunset, morn and dusk in the desert, ancient collapsed Beirut, sad bombed Babylon and Ur of old, Syria's grim mysteries, all Arabi and Saudi deserts, Yemen's sprightly folk, old opium tribal Afghanistan, Tibet temple Baluchistan, see Shanghai again, nor cares of Dun Huang, nor climb East 12th Street's stairway, three flights again, nor go to literary Argentina, accompany glass to Sao Paulo, and live a month in a flat, Rio's beaches and favela boys, Bahia's great carnival. Nor more daydream of Bali, too far of Adelaide's festival to get new song sticks, not see the new slums of Jakarta, mysterious Borneo forests and painted men and women. No more Sunset Boulevard, Melrose Avenue, Oz on Ocean Way, old cousin Danny Ligand, memories of Aunt Edith in Santa Monica. No more sweet summers with lovers, teaching Blake at Naropa, mind writing slogans, new modern American poets, Williams Kerouac, Reznikov, Rakosi, Corso, Creeley, Orlovsky. Any visits to benign Israel graves of Bubba, Aunt Rose, Harry Meltzer, Aunt Clara, Father Louis? Not myself, except in an urn of ashes. So thank you, Ellen. Thank you, everyone.
I was just, when Elliot was talking about the typing for Allen, I just realized that the first time I met Allen was in early 1975, when someone, I don't remember who, another poet called and said, oh, would you do some typing for Allen? It was a habeas corpus for Timothy Leary. And I said, oh yeah, okay, I'll do that. I, you know, you just had your little, you know, manual typewriter, and I was so nervous. You know, but when Allen came over, when we lived on East 12th Street, the same place that he had lived, moved in later. And actually, Bob reminded me that when he came over to do that typing, where I typed for the Leary corpus, there was an empty apartment in our building, and he was sort of asking about looking to move, and we told him about it, and then he moved in a few years later, where he lived for already over 20 years until recently. But I thought it was funny that I guess that's sort of a way that a lot of people got with Alan or got kind of like exposed to Alan or got initiated into Alan was through typing some way. And the other odd thing was one of the last things, not the last thing I did, but when we found out that Alan was so gravely ill and there was this big rush to type up, Alan wanted to see all of his poems that he'd been had been writing in his journal, and he wanted to do all this editing, you know, at the last couple of weeks of his life, and there was this big push to type things up, and it was very busy and crazy. And I said to Bob, I'll come in and type in the office. And he called me before I came in that day, and he said, would you look up the word Kinderlach? And and we have a Joys of Yiddish at home, so I looked up in Leo Rostin's Joy of Yiddish, and Kinderlach, meaning in the diminutive, little children. And in the actual explanation of it said, to express special affection to friends, a gathering, a dinner party, a committee, one may say, well, Kinderlach. So when I think about that, it's like, it's not just children, literally, it's really people coming together, joining together, and like people here are, I guess in some way, we're all Alan's children.
It's good to be here today. I would like to introduce Hannah Honey Litsky. Her name was Ginsburg, maiden name. And I want to introduce also Edith Ginsburg, Louis' wife. I'd like them to stand up. These are remarkable women. They're very young and wonderful friends. I guess Honey's big claim to fame is that she was Philip Roth's English teacher. And they're still in touch. What I really want to do is to go back to Alan's roots. He just didn't become a poet. He followed in the footsteps of his father, Louis, who was a Patterson poet. A wonderful man and a teacher, and certainly inspired Alan and his brother Eugene, Eugene Brooks Ginsburg. Eugene dropped the Ginsburg at some time after his marriage.
Like almost everyone in this room, I probably have a couple of stories, as you do, about Alan, and I couldn't make up my mind which one to talk about. The first time I met Alan was at the Great Falls Festival in the 70s, and I was backing up my car and almost ran him over. I mean, and I remember his red shirt and his suspenders. He's with his entourage, and he was like really making not such friendly remarks to me. And then whenever he signed everyone's books, he would ask their names, and then he would sign his name, but he didn't ask me my name. He just signed his name to my book. And so that was my first time. I met him again. I actually got to meet his stepmother, Edith. I sat next to her. I think it was at William Patterson. And this time, after my reading, I actually got a kiss from Alan. So that was a little better start. And I think I really got to know Alan when I was living with Gregory Corso, or rather Gregory Corso was living with me. And I was very fortunate to have a chance to meet Alan that way. And though we didn't meet too often, it was always very intense. And I thought, well, maybe I can tell this story about, I think it was his 57th birthday, it was in 1983, and we had this little birthday dinner at the Odeon, and it was Gregory and myself and his cousin Mindy and Brian, and I think it was Lucian's wife, whose name I don't remember, but I do remember the wonderful blue denim jacket she wore. And we wrote this collaborative poem, which was really, I thought, absolutely awful. Everybody contributed a line, so. But maybe I'm wrong, but anyway. And then I got to know Alan again several times. In 1984, I went to his reading at Stevens, and he came back to my house, and it was just the two of us for dinner. It was not, again, an auspicious meeting. At the beginning, I'd had a flat tire. I seemed to have a lot of car problems when I was with Alan. And he came back, but it was a really, really good evening, and I wrote a poem about it called, which I'm not going to read to you now, let's see what the name is, the night Allen Ginsberg refused to go to a bar, go on, when a guy asked him to go to the bar scene in Hoboken and said, I have a date with Laura, so.
I feel very honored, Maria, to be here, and I thank you. At a poetry reading at the Patterson YMHA, October 23rd, 1966, Allen Ginsberg told his audience he had visited the Passaic Falls where we were this morning, had been impressed by their beauty, and had smoked marijuana to heighten the experience. Mayor Francis X. Graves, Jr., who was known for his unpredictability and his love of publicity, God bless him, read this in the paper and ordered a warrant issued for Allen Ginsberg's arrest. Allen returned to Patterson Municipal Court to answer the charges in February of 1967 because he wanted to read poetry with his father at Patterson, then Patterson State College, in March. The old municipal court was in the old police headquarters. It was off to the left of the entrance, and about 60 persons were in the small green room. It smelled of fresh paint. Fluorescent lights hanging from the high ceiling were barely enough to light the room. Large windows along one wall provided no light or open space because they faced the brick wall of a warehouse about 4 feet away. The parade in front of the bench consisted of persons charged with malicious mischief and drunkenness. Allen watched them very closely. His legs were crossed under the seat, and one shook nervously. Then, at about 9:40 a.m., his name was called, and he stood in front of the bench looking up at a cowboy lanky judge named Irvin Kushner. At 40, Ginsberg was almost bald on top. Long black hair billowed out from the sides and rear of his head over the back of his white shirt and rumpled gray suit. His shaggy beard, speckled with gray, covered the knot of his necktie and the top of a well-worn gray and white striped sweater. Electric blue socks showed between his gray buff three-quarter shoes and baggy pants. An Indian medallion hung from a chain around his neck. "What have I got here?" Judge Kushner asked the bailiff. An official read the charge. Did use a narcotic drug for purpose other than treatment for sickness, etc. Allen looked very uncomfortable as he leaned his arm on the judge's bench. Judge Irvin Kushner dismissed the charge, saying a public statement does not a confession make. And Allen left beaming, bowing before the judge with his hands in front of him as if he were praying or thanking him. Outside, he came with his father, Lewis, and friends, and to celebrate, they went to the Donut Kettle across the street for tea and donuts. I had a beard then, and that was a very rare thing in Patterson in 1967, and when he came out and he saw me, he said, "What are you, the local pothead?" And Lewis invited me across the street to have a donut. Lewis Ginsberg, beardless, impeccable in a checked sport jacket and black and gold tie, was telling someone with fatherly indignation, they had no proof except Allen's word, which was doubtful.
Hi, I'm Joel Gaidamack, Allen Ginsberg's first cousin. We were very close for many, many years. or before his famous entry into the world stage, or onto the world stage, as a poet, philosopher, and certainly friend of the world. Alan was loved by many people. I never realized by how many. I am a physician. I was with him the last 16 hours of his life, tending to him when he went into coma. The last words that he spoke were to me, saying that he was tired, he just wanted to sleep. He lay back in his bed and said to me, "Why don't you read some of my latest poems? They're over there on the chair." I reached over, started to read them, looked up. He was asleep. He never awoke. He died at 2:39 the next morning. Many people were saddened by his passing, certainly all of his friends and people that he touched around the world. He was very kind, he was always honest, and very generous, wonderful person. I'll miss him dearly, as will the world. Thank you.
It's kind of bittersweet to be here today, but we are celebrating Alan's life, and that's the good part, but it also makes me realize personally how much I miss him.
Thank you. My name is Rochelle Kraut, and I'm very happy to be here participating in this event, this memorial reading with Allen Ginsberg, and hearing how Alan really touched the lives of so many people here in New Jersey, and just happy to hear what they had to say. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Joe Verrill. I'm a teacher at Kennedy High School in Patterson. I performed with the Silk City Poets years ago, and I'm still pretty active in poetry. And I just want to thank Alan for allowing all of us to be able to write. All these working class kids from these working class families that really didn't have, in a sense, the right to write, he opened that door. And now all kids in Patterson can express themselves, and I want to thank him for that. So thank you once again, Alan.
I just want to say that I really enjoyed the honor that was given to Allen Ginsberg because of the issues that he dealt with, and I think he was a great humanitarian, and listening to the various people talk about him really inspired me, just to encourage me, to let me know that all people care about people and focus on various issues, and that's what he did. So as a poet, it inspired me to be a lot more caring and concerned about other people, and to deal with issues that Allen Ginsberg focused on, and I honor him for that. And it was a great day, and we had a very good crowd here, and I really enjoyed it. Very inspiring. Thank you.
Well, today was one of the busiest days we've ever had here at the Patterson Museum. We've seen about 400 people, and I'm proud to say that this is an excellent day in terms of the visitation and the exchange of ideas and knowledge and of cultures. It was a really tremendous day. It was a beautiful day, and I'm proud to be part of it. Thank you.
My name is George James. I'm a reporter for the New York Times, and I worked in Patterson for the Patterson Morning Call from 1964 until the paper went out of business in 1969. And it was my pleasure to meet Allen Ginsberg and his father as they were leaving Municipal Court, where Allen had just been forced to go because he had acknowledged that he had smoked marijuana at the Passaic Falls. And the judge threw it out, saying that doesn't constitute a confession. However, what struck me about him then, more than his poetry, I didn't know what to expect, but what I saw was a really kind person and his father, a really kind man. And they invited me from that point on to their joint poetry readings. And I got to know them and Edith Ginsberg through that. And what always struck me was they were a loving family. And Alan, for all his alleged wildness and you know, bad boy of poetry, unconventional, was really quite a decent, honorable guy who lived a normal life, basically, or wanted those values that he learned with Louis. And so I was very touched today by many of the things that the people said who knew him much better than I did, and it seemed to all fit into kind of a pattern giving sort of a more complete picture of the man.
Hello, I'm Elliot Katz, a New Brunswick poet and activist. I met Alan quickly in 1976, but got to know him after studying with him for a month at Naropa Institute in Boulder in 1980. It was a real pleasure to be here today. I'd like to really thank Maria Gillen for organizing this. What we got a chance to see was a lot of people who knew Alan and admired Alan from a lot of different places. Alan was incredibly good at making people feel special, at bringing friends from different scenes together, and at inspiring people in a lot of different ways. For me, Alan was always influential both as a great poet and as an important political activist, somebody who really set an example of how one could live a principled life that was both poetically motivated, politically charged, and filled with spiritual compassion and personal integrity.
I'm Sander Zuloff. I edit the Journal of New Jersey Poets, and I was just really had to be here today to celebrate the memory of Allen Ginsberg, who was so important to New Jersey and to poetry and to the world. I mean, transcendent is a good word to describe his effect on people. And I think Maria Gillen deserves an enormous amount of credit, more credit perhaps than she will ever get, for bringing Alan back to Paterson and for uniting this terrific poetic legend with the city of Paterson and making that whole and making him a part of the poetry scene. Because without her, there would be no scene here. There would be no poetry in Paterson, and she's made it happen. So it's a terrific day for Alan. It's a terrific day for Paterson. And also, it's a terrific day for Maria, who's done so much, I think, for the art of poetry in New Jersey. And I was very happy to be able to be here today and celebrate this this great American poet.